So, welcome to the official beginning of these classes. After the prerequisites, now I really want to go into medias res and talk about the canonical commutation relations, but also their underlying functional analytic properties. So namely, this will be about unbounded operators. Okay, so actually, so this will be chapter 3. After the requisites on Hilbert spaces and bounded operators, now we will talk about unbounded operators. Yeah, and maybe let me start with the motivation. So why do we have to deal with unbounded operators? Bounded operators are quite nice, so why not stay with them? And the reason is that, okay, the operators which show up in quantum mechanics are usually unbounded operators. And in particular, we will be interested in these canonical commutation relations, and the first thing we will see is that there are no bounded operators which satisfy them. So what we want to understand during the course of this lecture series are possible realizations of the so-called canonical commutation relations, which are usually just abbreviated by CCR, canonical commutation relations. And those relations, yeah, what are they? They are relations for two operators. And they say, so let's say the operators are called Q and P. So they say that Q times P minus P times Q is I times the identity. So I have two operators. I mean, Q corresponds to the position operator, P to the momentum operator in physics. And the commutator should be I. And in physics, I also have the H bar here, a constant. But, I mean, in mathematics, this doesn't play a role, so we just put this equal to 1. And then this 1 is the identity operator on my Hilbert space. And this I, of course, is the square root of minus 1. And this should show up here because I also want that Q and P are self-adjoint. So if I take the joint of this, then of course this side changes the sign. And so this side should also change the sign. Yeah, but for now, don't care about self-adjointness. This will come later. So just think about what are relations of this. And of course, one has very canonical relations. So maybe the ones which one usually considers in physics and maybe come up to mind directly if you see those relations. So the immediate realizations are given. They are given on canonical version of an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, namely on, let's say, the L2 of R. So those are the measurable functions on R, which are square integrable. And then those operators are just multiplication and differentiation operators. So on L2 of R, this Hilbert space, I have two operators, Q. This will be the multiplication operator. So the multiplication is the argument. And P will be the differentiation operator. Differentiation operator, which are given, at least formally. So I mean, this is not yet rigorous, but just let's do it formally. So Q acts on, so elements in the L2 space are functions, functions of a real variable. So let's say F, I denote this function, and then Q on F is again a function of T. And what is the effect of Q on a function F? It multiplies F of T with T. So it multiplies with the argument. And of course, this has to be understood in the almost sure sense. My functions are L2 functions, so I can modify them on null sets. Okay, so this looks very innocent. Maybe P is a bit more complicated, namely P is the differentiation operator. So if I have my function f, so what should be the value of P of f at the point t? This should be, okay, I need a minus I. This is just to get the signs here and the I right. And then the main point is that I take the derivative of my function. And of course, I cannot take the derivative of any L2 function. So this already indicates that I will have kind of problems of really making this rigorous. It's not clear how to define this on all functions. Probably I cannot do it. So of course, I just write it down formally. And later, we will have to think about the domain. But of course, now, if I have these two operators, then of course, you see that this relation here is very easily satisfied. So namely, formally, so let's say for functions for which all this makes sense, so then formally, if I calculate qp minus pq applied to f at the point t, so what is this? So here I first apply p and then q, and here I first apply q and then p. So here, I first take the derivative and then multiply with the argument. And here, I'm doing it the other way around. So I get, for the first term, maybe let me continue here. So I get minus I. P always contains this minus I. This just gives me here minus I. Then P on F is a derivative and then multiplied with T. So here I have T times f prime of t, and I'm subtracting, first multiplying it with t, and then taking the derivative. So I'm taking, first I multiply my function with t, and then I take the derivative, which of course, by the product rule for the differentiation, is of course the derivative of this guy times this, so it's f of t plus, and then I get this times the derivative of this plus t times f prime of t. And you see, this term here cancels with this term, and I'm just left with this term. Here I have a minus, here a minus, so I get a plus, and this I survives. So what I have is really just plus I times f of t. But f of t, this is just the identity operator applied to f. I'm just reproducing f with this. Is the action of this operation. Okay, I also get a factor I. Also, you see, at least formally, those two operators satisfy exactly these commutation relations. Yeah, good. Okay, but of course, you see, one problem is that those operators, if I write it down like this, are not really defined everywhere, and maybe more problematic is that those operators are not bounded. So that's first thing one should see. So however, those P and Q are not bounded. So even if I maybe if I define them only on a dense subset, for example here only on the functions which are differentiable, then even on restricted to this set, the operator norm is not bounded. Okay, so this means, yeah, there are canonical realizations of these canonical commutation relations, but those are not bounded operators. Yeah, but of course this doesn't mean that there cannot be bounded operators from this, so maybe we just have taken a bad example, but it turns out that actually there are no bounded operators which satisfy this relation. So this is maybe more interesting part here. So actually, there are no bounded operators satisfying the CCR relations. And this then really tells us, if you really want those relations, and physics tells us that we should look for operators satisfying those, then we need an extension of our class of operators. Yeah, but so maybe let me prove this statement, which I made here, because this is actually quite easy, so this is not nothing deep or complicated, but this is a quite straightforward calculation. But it's a basic, of course, it's a basic fact for what we are doing. No? So let me write it down again. So there are no P and Q bounded operators on any Hilbert space which satisfy this canonical commutation relation. So satisfying QP minus PQ is I times the identity. And actually, I don't have to require that P or Q are self-adjoint here. So I mean, in physical terms, we always want our main operators to be self-adjoint. So in particular, P and Q should be self-adjoint. But this is not really important for seeing that there are no such operators. Yeah, so the proof of this, let us assume that there are such operators. So assume I have bounded operators satisfying QP minus PQ is I times the identity. And then I claim, first of all, that this implies also relations between Q to the power and P. So from this, I'm claiming, thus, we have for all natural numbers also the relation that Q to the power n times P minus P times Q to the n is equal to I times n times Q to the n minus 1, and also that Q to the n minus 1 is not equal to 0. So that's part of my claim. So I'm claiming this for all n. And of course, this can be seen by induction. So for n equal to 1, this is exactly my original CCR relation. If n is equal to 1, I have here QP minus PQ. And here I have just I times Q to the 0, which is, of course, the identity. And of course, the identity is not equal to 0. So for n equal to 1, this is clear. So I'm proving this now by induction. And if I have this, then it will follow quite easily that this cannot be. So this is by induction. N equal to 1 is okay. That's just our assumption of the CCR relation. Now let's see if I have it for n. How do I get it for n equal to, for n plus 1? So I want to see what is Q to the n plus 1 times P minus P times Q to the n plus 1. And of course, I should reduce it to what I already know for to the power n. And this I'm writing in the usual form if you're dealing with products and kind of derivatives. So maybe you should have in mind those. The P is kind of, it's like a derivative. So we are doing here somehow derivatives on the Q. So let me write this as Q to the n times Q times P. So this is Q to the n plus 1, P, this is this term. Then here I'm bringing in the PQ, because that's also something which I know. But then I'm adding the term Q to the n, P, and here I'm subtracting P times 2 Q to the n times Q. So this last term is P, Q to the n times Q is Q to the n plus 1. So this is minus this term. And this term here cancels with this one, because this is Q to the n, PQ, Q to the n, PQ. Here is a plus and here is a minus. So I just have written this in a kind of telescopic, one small telescope sum here. But now we know, of course, something about this and something about this. So this is our case n equal to 1, which we already have from the very beginning. So this is I times the identity. And this is the case equal to n. And for this, we assume that we already know this. So this here is I times n times q to the n minus 1. So here I have q to the n minus 1 times q, which is q to the n. Here I also have q to the n times 1. Also q to the n, and here I have an i, here I have an i, here I have a 1, and here I have n, so I get n plus 1 times the identity. So the whole thing here is now I have the I, and then I have n plus 1 times q to the n. Yeah. And so this is one part of our claim, namely that I have this equality. But then the second part is that what I get here should also be different from 0. But this is clear, because if this is equal to 0, then q to the n must be equal to 0. But then this commutator here would also be equal to 0. But by assumption, or by our assumption on case n, this is also different from 0. Okay, so if I assume the case for n, I get it for n plus 1. So I also have that this here is different from 0, because otherwise q to the n times p minus p times q to the n is equal to 0, if I assume that q to the n is equal to 0. Yeah, so this means this equation star here is true for each n, for all n. If I assume I have it for n equal to 1, I get this for all n. But this now, my claim, or this leads now directly to a contradiction. I mean, we want to show a contradiction. I want to show if I assume the CCR, then I get a contradiction. If I assume I have bounded operators. But if I have bounded operators, those operators have finite, they are bounded, so they have finite operator norm, and so I can apply norms, this operator norm, to my equations, and then see what I get. Yeah, so let us take the operator norm of this equation. So from this equation star, we get, let me start on the right-hand side. So I take the norm of this here. Okay, so I, the norm of I is 1, then n comes out, and I get the norm of q to the n minus 1. So I get the norm, I get n times the norm of q to the n minus 1. And this is the norm of what I have on the other side. So this is the norm of q to the n times p minus p times q to the n. Yeah, but now I know the norm is really a norm, actually also a norm in the Banach algebra. So this means I have the triangle inequality. So first, I have the usual triangle inequality with respect to the addition. So this is less or equal than the norm of this plus the norm of this. So I have here the norm of q to the n times p plus the norm of p times q to the n. And of course, I also have the multiplicative triangle inequality, so namely the norm of a product is less or equal than the product of the norms. So this term here is less or equal. I keep this q to the n, and I have the p. So I have the product of q to the n and p, so this is less than the norm of q to the n times the norm of p. And of course, this guy is the same. It's also less than this guy, so I have actually this twice. So I have here less or equal 2 times the norm of q to the n times the norm of p. Yeah, and now on the other side of my inequality, I have the norm of q to the n minus 1. So for this reason. Maybe I also estimate this here by splitting up a factor q. So I'm writing q to the n as q to the n minus 1 times q, and then I apply again this triangle inequality. So this is less than q to the n minus 1, the norm of this times the norm of q. And so what I have here is that the norm of q to the n minus 1 is less or equal 2 times the norm of q to the n minus 1 times the norm of q. So this norm of q to the n minus 1 appears on both sides, and I have an inequality. This norm is a positive quantity, so I want to divide by it. The only problem would be if the norm of this is equal to 0. Yeah. But the norm in a normed space can only be equal to 0 if the element itself is equal to 0, so if q to the n minus 1 would be equal to 0. But part of our claim here was that this is not 0. So it's important also to include this statement here in my induction. So this means the norm of q to the n minus 1 is not 0, and I can divide this inequality by this, and the norm is always positive, so I keep the inequality sign. So this, let me write, so since q to the n minus 1 is not 0 by our induction claim, we have that the norm of it is also not equal to 0, and then we can divide, and then if I divide here by this norm, I'm left with the n, and on the other side, so this q to the n minus 1 goes away, I'm left with the 2, with the q, and with the p. So I have here 2 times the norm of q times the norm of p. Yeah, but this has now to be true for all n, because this equation, and here different from 0, is valid for all n. So for all natural numbers, but then this tells me that the natural numbers are bounded by 2 times the norm of q and the norm of p. So if q and p are both bounded operators, then each of them has a finite operator norm, and of course then this cannot be true. So this is a contradiction, which shows that this cannot be true. So at least one of them, I mean, one of those guys must be cannot be bounded. So if it could happen that one is bounded and the other is unbounded, such possibilities are possible. But both being bounded is not possible. Yeah. So this shows now that if we want to deal with the CCRs, we should extend our frame, not just look on bounded operators, but allow more general possibilities. And so what we are dealing with now are unbounded operators. And so let me now give a definition what I mean with an unbounded operator. So I mean in the following, if I'm talking about operators, I usually mean unbounded operator. And of course, I always mean a linear operator. So an operator, for me, is an unbounded linear operator. So sometimes I'm writing unbounded. If I forget it, it's always meant unbounded operator T. So this is, again, an operator on a Hilbert space. On a Hilbert space. H. So what is this? So this is given, and first of all, an unbounded operator, at least the ones we really are interested in, usually cannot be defined on all of the Hilbert space. As we saw in the beginning, the examples which I wrote down, if I take the derivative operator, then I have no idea how I should define this on all L2 functions, and actually doesn't really make sense. So I can only define it on a subset of the L2 functions, those which are in some sense, maybe in the most general sense, differentiable. And so this means in general, an unbounded operator will not be defined everywhere, but only on a subset of my Hilbert space. And of course, this subset should be linear, because I want to say that the operator is linear, it should act on a linear space. So this is given by, first let's say a domain where it is defined, which I usually denote by D of T, the domain of T. So this is a subset of my Hilbert space. But of course, at least this should be linear. So this is a linear. Subspace of my Hilbert space. Yeah, and then if I have a linear space where my operator acts, I can say my operator should be linear. So my operator itself, so this is now a linear mapping, T, which is defined on its domain and which takes on values in the Hilbert space. And of course, linear mapping is clear. T of a sum is the sum of the T's, and also if I multiply with a scalar. And yeah, maybe here I just said this is a linear subspace, and usually we require that this subspace is dense in H. I mean, it should not be too far away. So the typical situation, and the one in which we're interested, is the one that the domain of my operator is not necessarily everything, but it should be at least a dense subset. So that's also implicitly usually assumed, usually if I'm talking about unbounded operators. So usually we assume that D of T is dense in H. Yeah, and of course, I mean, unbounded is to be understood in a sense of not necessarily bounded. So I mean, a bounded operator will also be an example of an unbounded operator. I mean, then of course it's defined everywhere and it is bounded, but unbounded operators include the bounded ones, but of course we are now mainly interested in properties which are different from the ones, or we have to understand unbounded operators in general. And then of course everything which is true for unbounded operators will also be true for bounded operators. But the situation for unbounded operators in general is usually more complicated. Yeah, so maybe let me do an example. Namely coming back to one of the two operators which I had in the beginning as an example for the canonical commutation relations. And let us take the easier one. I mean, we will talk later quite a bit about the derivative operator, how to define it, and what properties and problems we have there. The position operator is somehow easier, but still we see there quite explicitly what the problem with the domain is and why this is unbounded. Yeah, so let me take as an example the position operator. So this was the multiplication operator, which usually we denote with Q. So the Hilbert space is the L2 space of R, and let me recall again just very explicitly what this is. So those are the functions from R to C which are measurable and which are square integrable. So this means if I take the integral over the absolute value of my function f of t squared, integral with respect to dt, integral with respect to Lebesgue measure, this should be finite. So this is my L2 space, and on this space I define this operator Q in the same way as I wrote it down before. So Q of F, so this should be now a new function. So at T, this is given by multiplying F of T with its argument T. And of course, this can now only be defined, or I'm going to define this only for functions which land again in L2. Of course, I want a mapping to L2, so which means if I do this multiplication with t, I should get a function which is again in L2. And a general function in L2, if I multiply it with t, won't be in L2. So this means this definition here, as a mapping between L2 and L2, makes not sense for all functions f, but only for functions in the domain of my operator. And of course, now I have to define the domain, and of course, I define the domain in a way that I actually require that what I get here is again in L2. So in this case, the domain is very, very easy, and it's clear. I mean, I take the biggest possible domain where this definition makes sense. So where the domain of Q is just the L2 functions, such that also after multiplying it with t, they are still L2 functions. So L2 functions means that this is less than infinity, but if I'm multiplying f with the argument, then if I'm taking the L2 norm of this, then this means I get t squared times f of t squared dt should be finite. Okay, and I mean this is, okay, so if this is finite, this doesn't mean that this has to be finite. So this means these are not all L2 functions, but only a subset of L2. Of course, it's a linear subset, and it's also quite easy to see that it is a dense subset. So this is really a domain which we require in our usual definition. So this is dense in L2 of R, but it is not equal. It's not everything. And so this means here we see explicitly that we have to restrict our domain, because if we want to make this definition and we want to land in L2, I mean, then we have to restrict the f's for which this makes sense. And yeah, this unboundedness is also something which one sees very explicitly here, namely this q is unbounded. Of course, now unbounded on its domain. So this means the q increases the length of functions of norm 1 arbitrarily high. And this is also quite clear in this example. So note that q is unbounded. On its domain, that's of course only where I can apply the q. And so why is this? So because if I take functions, I multiply functions with its argument. And so this means if I have a function which is localized around a high number in R, then the argument, the argument there will also be a high number. So let's say here is 0, and let's say I go to t0, and I'm looking on functions which are mainly have a support very close to this t0. So, and then the effect of q, it multiplies with the argument, but this function only essentially lives here. So essentially, this multiplies with t0. This is just now formal, but I mean, of course, you can make this precise. So the effect of q is, in principle, it's close to multiplication just with t0. And now, of course, I can take an f, which is localized very close to t0, such that the L2 norm is equal to 1. So I take an f such that the integral over f2 squared dt is equal to 1. So for example, I take here a small interval of length epsilon, and then it takes on maybe the constant value 1 over epsilon, or 1 over square root of epsilon. And then this guy here is equal to 1. But then if I calculate the corresponding norm of the image under Q, then of course I should calculate t squared, f of t squared dt. And now I'm integrating only over a small interval here, where the t is essentially t0. So let's say this here is roughly t0, which I can take out, so it's t0 squared And then I have the integral over f squared, which is equal to 1. So you see that for such functions, the effect of q is that the length 1 of my function is changed to a length which is t0. So this means, okay, so this is the square of the length. So I should take the square root of those things. But so this means that the norm of q of f divided by the norm of f, that the sub of this is the operator norm, that this can become arbitrarily large. Because if I take functions like this, then this quotient is close to t0, and I can make t0 as big as I want, because I take functions on R, on all of the reals, so the t0 can be any real number. So this here can become arbitrarily large. And so this means that the operator norm of q, in this case, is equal to infinity. Or that q is not continuous with respect to the norm.